There we go. All right, I'll call the Finance Committee meeting of Monday, January 9th, 2017, to order. The first thing on our agenda tonight is to meet with representatives from the school project to give us a brief presentation on the status of the project and field some questions from us or whatever we have, and kind of have a nice, I know that the project's doing well, so I'm going to turn the floor over to you so that you can introduce yourselves and give us a presentation.
Thank you very much for having us. My name is Joel Seeley from Simmons Van McKee. We're the Orange Project Manager. And with me tonight is Carol McCoy from Eric Kinshire's office, our CPA, who's handling all of the MSBA interface relative to financial reimbursement. So and also with us tonight is Barbara Davis from the Building Committee. So we have a brief presentation relative to the status of the construction. We have a video that we've been doing, video updates for the Building Committee, generally about every other month. So this is from November. So we'll kind of go through that first and then jump right into the financials. Carol's handed out a financial package to all of you. That was the document that was presented to the Permanent School Building Committee at their December monthly meeting. And so without further delay, why don't I jump right into the video? And this was our November Permanent School Building Committee presentation for construction update. So in the foreground is the elementary school wing. We'll be taking a video flyover of the building's progress. This was done in November. There's no snow on the ground, but the building, the brick exterior is done, the windows are complete, the roofing's complete. And as we kind of go around the building, you'll start to see all of the HVAC units that have been installed on the roof with the screening. In the foreground there with the silver piping, that's our temporary heating system. We have three temporary heaters for the building to heat the building during the winter. This is the gymnasium with the light gray above and the brick below. The loading dock is actually enclosed in temporary enclosure because we were doing some interior masonry there. This is the back of the building. On the bottom right is the school district offices. You'll see here the STEM corridor for the exterior STEM projects. This is the middle school, high school wing, and all of the concrete sidewalks that we've been pouring all fall are pretty much complete. Making our way now towards the middle school, high school entry. And the front portion of the building, which has the copper shingles, are well underway. All the windows have been installed. You can just see in the foreground there, they're just prepping for the concrete pours in the front plaza. That's the existing building and the various patching on the existing building roof that's been done over the years. And this shows the location of the new building relative to the existing building. Inside, this is a view of the elementary school library. There's three skylights in that room. Looking down now towards the middle school, high school cafeteria. This is that STEM corridor where we'll do all of the STEM projects. Again, the middle school, high school cafeteria, looking up towards the library media center. This is the elementary school cafetorium. There's the stage opening in the background. And this is the gymnasium, which has both the middle school, high school side, as well as the elementary school side. If you go there today, you'll see actually painted walls, ductwork, and a lot of the basketball court backstops being hung. So a lot of progress since our November report, but I thought this might give us a flavor of kind of where the status of the project is. And so with that, I'd like to turn it over to Carol.
Thank you. Hi, everybody. I'm Carol McCoy. I work for Eric Kinsherf. I'm the principal person responsible for doing the MSBA reimbursement requests, putting everything into their ProPay system, and just keeping track of all the project costs. So, as you can see, we have $102,967,198 total project costs, and right off the bat, ineligible costs were determined for $22,308,343. The reimbursement rate at 69.12, with the maximum grant reimbursement from the MSBA of $55 million and change, leaves the total cost to the town of $47,215,797.42. Currently, we have $52,624,539 paid to vendors to date. The reimbursements received only through submission number 23 is $28,176,036. We are expecting 5.375629 on submissions number 24 and 25. And the cost of the town so far through submission 25 is $19,078,274. Of the ineligible costs, we've delineated all of the different categories. So accounting for our firm is total to date is $18,844. Legal fees, $25,264. There were some travel expenses that are ineligible. For Flansburg, Mr. Moriarty, First Student, and Chartwells, $185, $220, $195, and $343, respectively. There was a regionalization study to Gatehouse Media for $487, ineligible, and reimbursements to individuals, Ms. Jean Moore and Elizabeth Tolson, $43 and $643, respectively. Sales tax obviously is ineligible in two submissions, one from Consigli Construction for $455 and one to Sims SMMA for $120. Catering, $133 to Smith's Restaurant and Catering. And Conservation Commission reporting services to Conference and Court reporting services were ineligible for $475. The Consigli submissions for the concession stand of $55,852 are ineligible. And this next item, it says unsupported items, research has commenced. I have resubmitted that $2,200 submission actually today. So that has gone. They were just missing some supporting documentation. That would probably be more of a question for Joel.
That is the concession stand out near the football track field. MSBA has said all outbuildings are ineligible for reimbursement. It happens on every project. There is an outbuilding or two in every project, and just MSBA, the way they are categorized eligible or ineligible costs for the same treatment for every community across the Commonwealth.
So we're
building a concession stand, yes.
To date, the amount over basis of the total facilities grants totals $1,161,699. Once the final updated budget is approved, which it has been, I need to update the whole reporting. It wasn't available for this meeting, and this is the meeting that we were using our information from. This amount will be adjusted by the MSBA once they re-review everything. Once they re-review the budget as submitted on their system.
And so, I'm sorry, I don't want to jump in. So ahead. Some of that 746,000 or some of that
1.1 million.
Some of that 1.1, because it would be then built into the final budget, is then becomes reimbursable? But it wasn't in the 75% budget or the last revision of it. Does that make sense?
That's correct. The MSBA will be re-reviewing all of these submissions based on the new budget as entered.
Because as you went through the process, there were things you had to pull out to make the budget be on budget, but then you were able to do those things, and now if you can fit them within the total scope of the budget and they were originally planned for, they become reimbursable again?
Well, there's more the bid budget, correct?
Yeah, MSBA will make the determination on all of the reimbursability or eligibility for all change orders at the end of the job as they kind of go through. And so our job is to submit them. They'll continue to categorize them in this way, and they'll make that assessment. Generally, there is some percentage of change orders that are ineligible and some that are eligible. And MSBA will make that determination as we go along. But we're just categorizing them all now in the way that they've asked us to categorize them.
When would you know that they become eligible? Is it at the very end of the project in the summertime or whenever that they say yes, or when the budget's done? Or
I think at the final audit. And then we have an opportunity to review that final audit with them and say, you know, why are you determining this is ineligible?
Question why they questioned us.
Yeah.
So the total cost at $102 million, that's final. That number won't move.
That's correct.
So that's all. So what we're talking about now is how much is reimbursable versus how much is
not. And so the $22.3 million that was ineligible at the outset, is that $2 million adding to that number, or is it part?
Part.
Okay. Thank you.
Can you go back one?
So out of curiosity, what is the contingency costs that are reimbursable?
They all need to be reviewed by the MSBA. When they've reviewed them, at the time they reviewed them, the PFA bid budget had not yet been entered into the system. So as they go along, just in the last submission, they gave us $40,000 for some of the change orders. So it's going to be a continuing process by the MSBA in their review.
Is this $746,000 all contingency dollars that are being requested, or is there a subset that have already been approved such that contingency spent to date is higher than that 746?
The 746 is the amount that the MSBA has determined as contingency costs and change orders that are currently ineligible.
So what's the value that they've determined to be eligible?
As the change orders and everything get processed through the MSBA, more and more become eligible of that $746,000.
So can I just give you a if you had $1 million that you spent in contingency
so far, they, in an example, they would have given you $250,000, and $746,000 they've said hasn't been approved by them. Is that a good outline of how it would have worked? I'm not saying that those numbers are accurate,
right,
but
right.
That, and the $250,000 in that example would have been folded into one of the other payments that they made for us.
Right.
So that's why we're not seeing it in a contingency.
Exactly.
Goal.
And I may see in, like in the two reimbursements that we're expecting, I may see more money coming in for those contingency costs. And that number will go down. It will actually go up and down because of the more reimbursement requests that we enter.
What was the value of the line item of contingency in the budget?
I don't have the budget with me.
Yeah, I didn't bring the budget, but I believe our contingency balance is in excess of $4 million at the moment.
So it's probably in the neighborhood of $5 million?
Generally, yeah.
So of the $102,967,198 total school project expenses, we have expended 51% of, and that's $52,624,539. So the remaining school project expenses, sorry for the misspelling, will be $50,342,659. And of the MSBA grant of $55,751,401, we've received $28,176,36 at 51%. So the remaining MSBA grant available remains at $27,580,765. And of the $52 million figure, this is everything, all the vendors that we've paid that makes up that amount. So we have Chartwells, which that was, I believe, I don't think it was catering. I can't remember what Chartwells. Yeah, I can't remember.
Yeah, that was, I believe, part of the groundbreaking ceremony.
Okay. $343. We have that conference and court reporting services of $475. Consigli Construction, the main vendor, $44,757,533. Mr. Moriarty of $220. Mr. Kincher for $18,844. First Student, which is travel expenses, $195. We have Architects at $6,066,178, Gatehouse Media, $4,675, Gene Moore, $43, Kenneth Thompson, $788, the Attorneys Murphy, Hesse, Toomey, and Lehane of $25,264, National Grid, $2,658, Smith's Restaurant and Catering, $133, SMMA, $1,743,535, Elizabeth Tolson at $643, and Verizon for $3,010. So the total vendors paid through submission number 25 is $52,624,537. I think that's it, right?
Yeah.
Any questions? Any further questions?
Yeah, I was just wondering, on the bottom of this sheet, the last page there, you've got construction contingency,
mm-hmm.
but that might include two different types of contingency, or three, or something like that. Or
those are the budget revision requests.
What was the question?
So the $6 million that's sort of boxed out, is that multiple types of contingencies that are included in that, or is that the contingency?
That is that's the construction contingency. There's another contingency for the owner, for soft costs or engineering type contingencies.
The $802,000 down below.
Exactly. Yes.
So all totaled for the project, it's just under $7 million of contingency money that's been designated before we started for.
Yes, generally. Yes.
And you've only gone into that I don't know if I'm reading this right, $482,000, that's been?
Those are the budget revision requests through number 18.
Okay, yep. Through number 18, so there's still.
There are, yeah,
there's
continuing.
Because we're at number 25. There's a lag between the MSBA processing and getting back to us. And so the reporting that we have through here, through the budget revisions, is 18.
Is it the submission on a bi-weekly basis that we send it every 2 weeks and get it back, or how does that work, or just when we have it we send
no,
it?
We are allowed one per month.
Okay.
For the MSBA, and the Permanent School Building Committee meets usually the third Wednesday of the month, and it's usually the following Friday of the following week that invoices are able to be paid. So I'm usually about a week after that, I'm able to submit all the invoices, and it's usually between 4 and 6 weeks that
yep.
we get reimbursed.
From the building committee date and once the vouchers are approved to receipt of the reimbursement.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The total is about 4 to 6 weeks.
Yeah.
Yes.
Which is very good. It's very good because there's multiple signatures, multiple parties that are handling the documents, and it's a very good turnaround.
And when they reject it, obviously, it throws up red flags, so you do like you do to investigate it and find
exactly,
out
yeah.
why.
Yeah, we have our contact at MSBA and say, what's going on?
One question.
Go ahead.
Is the $746,000 of contingency costs on page 5, is this $482,000 on page 9 included in that $746,000 or on top of?
So
on page 5, you have contingency costs that are not eligible, and that's $746,000, the very bottom?
That are pending review, yes.
Okay, so you're carrying them as ineligible until they get approved.
Until the determination made.
Is the $482,000 on page 9 on top of that $746,000 or inclusive in that $746,000? Like, is the $482,000 already approved by them and bucketed, whether they pay it or they don't, and then the $746,000 is...
The page 9 is not related to eligible or ineligible. It's reflecting the amount of money that's being moved from one budget line item to another. And that process is a budget revision request through MSBA. And we have to request to modify the budget to move it from a contingency to a change order line item. And so what Carol was showing here was for through number 18, we had $482,000 in the budget revision requests from the contingency up to the change order budget.
Yes.
So that's for change orders. Some of them may have been reimbursable, some of them may not have been. That's just for the overall project. $482,000.
Yes. Through number 18.
Yep. Through 18, absolutely.
Yep.
Yeah.
Real quick. In theory, 7 months ago.
I'm sorry?
Because we're at 25 now and it's 18, roughly 6 months.
Exactly.
Just that I want to make sure everybody's on the same page.
Yep.
Very quick. What's a change order? How would
you? A change order.
Brief explanation.
Okay, we have our construction contract with the construction manager, Consigli Construction, and that is for a certain value. When there's a change in the scope through whatever means, there was something that was left off the drawings, there was something found in the site that, you know, created extra work, that would be a change order, an order to increase the either contract time or contract dollars for the construction contract. And some of those changes were related to value engineering items that were brought back into the project that were removed during the design phase for, you know, for managing the overall budget. Some of them were for issues of existing conditions on the site where earthwork or boulders or et cetera had to be accommodated. Or even the drought that we had this summer, relative to continuing the grass growing on the softball field and outfield.
You're not familiar with construction budgets like some of you, so that's common. That's where the money, the change order always comes out of the contingency fee. Hence, that's why it's, I'm not.
Yep.
Just make sure I understand. I mean, it makes sense.
Yes.
But I'm sure other people have the same question. I'm not down on one of these, so it goes to contingency, and then the change order comes in for whatever reason you just hit, and we apply it to the contingency fee, and you have to get approval from MSBA to change it from contingency fee to a change order budget.
And the Permanent School Building Committee. I mean, the Permanent School Building Committee is very prudent
in
setting
up
an appropriate contingency amount because that's the nature of construction.
That's right. Not being familiar, it made sense. I want to make sure I understood it.
One quick question I had. So on the ineligible cost section, the one that's jumping out at me is sales tax. Mm-hmm. And obviously we're building a school. So I would agree that why they don't want to reimburse us for sales tax. So is that something that we're also not paying for the sales tax and going to go back to whoever's charging us?
Those were two. I think there was two instances. One was my company, one was Consigli that got through, just didn't get it caught early enough before it was submitted to MSBA.
But
the vendors, those vendors that provided, it was probably printing, were paid the sales tax.
Have we gone back to them and said that they shouldn't be charging us the sales tax to get it back to us? Because they can, I mean, they can reimburse us the sales tax and the state doesn't.
Correct. We haven't gone back, but we certainly can.
I mean, it's not big money. I'm not, you know, it's just one of those things that stand out to me. I know that the town accountant always yells at us when we try and buy something from state.
Sure.
Submit sales tax.
Other questions?
Unrelated to the budget, has the manufacturer of the roof provided appropriate snow removal methods so that the roof doesn't get torn before we even enter the school? And do we have a structural limit of what, how much snow the roof can hold before you have to shovel it?
Yes, well, there's probably two questions in there, which is we're not complete with construction. The manufacturer, we haven't been provided with the manufacturer's warranty yet because we're still under construction. The relative to the quantity of snow, the structural engineer is designed it by the building code. I don't know the offhand the weights relative to snow retention, but the design does comply with Massachusetts building code in that respect.
Yes, and I'm not saying that it doesn't, and I'm not saying that I needed the exact figure. Just from my own experience, we recently had a problem. Like, if you had a winter like we did 2 years ago, you will have a much greater buildup of snow, and it was actually, you actually have to go up there and remove the snow, or else you're impacting the structural integrity of the building. So if we get a snow this year like we did 2 years ago,
I see. Okay.
Then I'm not sure where you're... we want to make sure we have something in place. Either they're still responsible for the roof, or sometimes they might turn that over earlier, and now you're responsible for it. And I'm just passing on something from a learning that I had in my history, that if we have a snow like we did 2 years ago, you could be compromising the roof before we even move in. And so therefore, you need to remove the snow. But in removing the snow, you could damage the roof, which my company also did. And so you just put a new roof on, and now you're paying another $1 million to fix it because you've invalidated the warranty.
Okay, understood.
And roofs are not cheap.
Yes, so that is correct.
I just want to make sure that...
You went up and shoveled it, no?
No, you can't. Well, no, I mean, you can.
He was joking. He said the permanent school building committee is going to have to go up and shovel.
Yeah.
Sorry.
And don't wear yak tracks.
Sorry. I do have a question to kind of put you on, and I hate to put you on the spot, for again, this looks great, I'm following whatever else, but not being construction. I've been saying, from what I've heard from other people, so pretty much we're on budget or under budget. I'm not going to hold you to anything, but for those who are listening, probably saying, oh, this is great, but, and I understand it, but is it, are we at the right spot where we're supposed to be as far as the budget goes, or are we, you know, is this 50%, which sounds great, right? Are we on target for our construction dates and all? It's the general, for anyone who's listening, to say, are we on or under budget, and are we on or on target for opening on January, whatever it's supposed to, September 18th?
We are on schedule to open up the school for the 2017-18 school year. We are under budget. I don't want to use an adjective relative to that, but we are under budget, and by all accounts, the project is going very well.
Good for that. Now, I want to get into the, after the school is turned over, what are the responsibilities that we've already made with MSBA in terms of building maintenance, budgets for building maintenance from an operational standpoint, so that we can understand what is going to be required to maintain that facility? And I don't want you to get into deep numbers, but are there things that we've agreed to with the MSBA that we will obviously maintain the building, but...
Yeah, the MSBA is your partner. Mm-hmm. And they've invested in the building along with the town. They have certain requirements to ensure that you are maintaining their investment. I don't remember the exact figures of your Chapter 70 money or your maintenance money. There's some amount that they would expect the town to provide maintenance. I think it's spelled out in your project funding agreement. But as you know, we look to down the road, and we occupy the building at the end of this summer, that maintenance for the building would start. We would still be constructing or demolishing the existing building and constructing the football and track complex through next late spring,
of 2018, but the maintenance of the building itself, the town would start starting this at the end of this summer.
Can you get that document you just referenced to Peter, and you get it to us, and so we we're on the same page,
sure,
as the Finance Committee to understand,
sure,
what that is? And then on the timeline, I think you just spelled it out, but in when would the actual new building plan to be turned over to the town so that we could begin to move in?
That would be June 2017.
So June of this year?
And we would it would be open to allow the installation of furniture and technology and fine-tuning of the systems. We wouldn't have the public occupy the building until the end of August.
And then you transition your work over to the new football field, demolishing the building. And what's the timeline on all the construction being completely done?
Well, in this summer, in theory, flip over the construction fence from one side to another. We would move our trailers onto the school side, the existing school side, do some fence modifications to allow construction access unimpeded and school access unimpeded, much like we did last, which we've been doing all construction. And then with that, existing building will be abated. That'll take some time for hazardous materials, primarily asbestos, to be removed from the building, and a demolition would occur. We would commence our earthwork operations and our site work operations for the football track stadium. That will go into next spring. There might be a pause in the winter, January, February, as a simply outdoor work, and then we would resume back in the spring with a June 2018 targeted completion for the project.
When do you expect certificate of occupancy?
We would expect certificate of occupancy for the building June 2017.
That's a good thing. You did stadium, not stadium. It would be the field construction area.
Yeah, the football and track.
Stadium,
yes.
Well, there's bleachers.
Bleachers. Stadium.
No, it's not.
Because we're getting stadium, it's not what we're getting.
Collect, right?
No, I'm just saying. My reaction to stadium, Clarence Gaffney also had the same reaction I
did.
Did we? For the dome. Okay, good.
Was the Permanent School Building Committee able to add back in lighting for the field?
That was in for the football and track complex. Yes. That's lit.
25%. I thought it pulled out.
And the entire project to be complete June of 2018.
Yes.
Questions? We've got the experts in the room. I don't think they want to come back to us, and we don't want to have them back. Unless there's a big problem, so get all the questions out. Any questions from any members of the audience that are here?
I think I mentioned it when we started this whole process about a year and a half ago. One thing I wouldn't underestimate is what it'll take to put together the maintenance and operations procedures to maintain the building from the day it's turned over, and to make sure that you get the appropriate drawings to do so, because that, A, is a lot of work, and B, if we shortchange ourselves on not buying the applicable drawings and documents, we're already at a loss for maintaining a new building.
Agree, absolutely.
What was the document that Permanent School Board Committee was going to get? Was
the
BFA? The project funding agreement. And I'm not sure if it spells out in there, but I will send that definitely to Peter.
Wherever that you can get that information from. And I understand it might not have numbers, it'll have percentages and all that kind of stuff, just so we can then backtrack.
Sure.
So separately, you're talking about the warranties of the systems and how to manage the systems and operate the systems.
If we're going to get the COO, the Certificate of Occupancy, in June of 2017, people should be engaged now to understand what's coming and kind of map out a plan so that the day they turn over the air handling units, people aren't like, oh crap, I got to write a procedure to maintain this. And it's not that I'm living it. So that's why I'm sharing the experiences, and we're just spending $100 million for a new school. I want to make sure on day one we're ready to go. So we're in 25 years, we're not in the same spot.
So our facilities gentleman over for the schools. He's working hand in hand with the architect and the construction company now.
Right.
To get all the information as far as maintenance, like how long this is going to last, when it needs to be cleaned, and when it should be this, and this. That's something that the Privet School Building Committee has assisted right from the get-go, and it's frequently on our agenda to see that this has happened. To make sure, like you say, that we get a building, and I was like, okay, great, and now what? So it's very important to the Primary School Building Committee that we do get a maintenance schedule and that we can track it. So they'll keep us updated on it as well.
Yeah, and actually, we probably need that in the first quarter of this year, because if there's any deltas in the budget starting July 1st, that has to be baked into it.
The Primary School Building Committee doesn't go away when this budget is out.
No, I understand that.
No,
I'm just
so that you'll know that we're still there, so that we can not oversee or control it, but to make sure that our interest in this stays and everything stays up to date. I mean, some people have to think, oh, you keep going? Like, yeah, this is going to die. You went to school.
The school's permanent. That's the idea of the permanent school. And can you just speak to when I attended one of the meetings, I know that in almost all of the vendors that are supplying products to us or installing products, that part of the agreements with all of them is that they go through a training process with our staff to get them up to speed on all that. You want to just speak to that quickly?
Yeah, there's training for all of the systems that's built into the contract. So each subcontractor owns a certain amount of as-built drawings, certain amount of O&M manuals, certain amount of training. That will be videotaped. It's all spelled out. We have a schedule of when that training would start and commence. Consigli's put that together along with Mike Bolger and the architect. One thing I should probably say is that one of the benefits of building right next to the junior senior high school is that Mike is able to attend all of the weekly construction meetings. You know, they're every Thursday morning, 8 o'clock, and it's excellent to have him at the table listening to all of the conversations relative to the building, and then we tour the building every week. So it's good.
It's nice to know what's behind the walls before the walls go up.
Yeah.
So I think I heard you say that manuals for all the equipment, training, the specification, the drawings of the equipment, that's all part of the contract. The training will also be via videotape?
Yes.
Okay. And we will be able to own the videotapes to use subsequently?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Yep.
Yep. Thank you.
And what's nice is that Consigli isn't going anywhere for the first year that the building's open, if you will. They're going to be on the other side of the fence. So if we need something, we could, you know, they're not that, kind of like the benefit right now of Mike being on the other side of the fence, that you've got
and
the access to staff. That it,
an excellent construction manager in Consigli.
Yeah.
Really excellent.
And there are things, you know, you mentioned the obvious ones like the HVAC, and I know you know, but there's so many other things that I learned from the last couple of meetings that you don't even really think of, like the stage curtains. You know, you got to know how to run those. You know, all these little things that you wouldn't necessarily think of, but they seem to be covering it all. I mean, they mention all these odd things that I never gave an ounce of thought to. So it's great.
And the warranties for how long after they build it? It's typically a couple of years.
Typically 1 year warranty for public construction. There are longer warranties for specific items, roofing warranty, boilers, you know, et cetera.
What was the structure, 1 year?
Yeah.
Any other questions? No. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
We've got a couple of things to go over, a couple of reserve fund transfer requests, and then we're just going to touch on the budget and what we've received to date and anything that we're missing so we can have the subcommittees kind of reach out and find out what's going on. So we have three reserve fund transfer requests. Number one is for $500 for the annual audit. The agreement for this year was for $32,500, but only $32,000 was budgeted. So that would be $500 short. The second item is for $250. This is for paying, this is your office also? For paying an assistant for an appointment stipend per the contract, and that was not budgeted.
Say that again, please, Kevin.
It's for $250, and it says we're paying an assistant for an appointment stipend per contract, but we'll get some clarification on what that means. And then $2,750 for COA coordinator salary, and this is for interim director and unforeseen retirement in the department. So why don't we take them, one and two, your office, if you want to speak to those.
Okay. The first one for the audit was budgeted. For the FY16 audit, it was a flat $32,000. That number was also brought forward to FY16, but we really owe them for the contract $32,500. So it's really just, we need an extra $500. They're going to be billing it soon because that audit is almost complete.
Questions on that?
The $250 in the clerical union contract under page 7, which I know you guys don't have a copy of it right now, but it talks about the different stipends. For example, you can get $1,000 if you have a full certification for your position. And then if you are appointed to an assistant position, you get another $250. So because I have an assistant who was appointed, all along actually she should have been getting this $250, but she never did. They just kind of missed that it was in this contract. So this reserve fund transfer is a request so that I can pay her the clerical contract.
And that's for FY17?
Correct. And then the COA is really Connie retired as of 12/1. Cindy as the interim started as of 12/1. So we had to pay Connie out for 5 weeks vacation time, which actually totaled the $2,750. Cindy's getting paid at the exact same rate that Connie was getting paid for. So because we owe Cindy the money from the exact day, actually, that Connie left, and I had to pay Connie 5 weeks out for vacation, I need a reserve fund transfer to have the money in the budget to pay the interim director.
5 weeks vacation was accrued.
Correct. Yes, it was accrued as of 7/1 on. It's what?
For the case.
Say that again?
We should be paying for the case.
We did. So that's what I paid Connie out for her vacation when she retired.
Oh, I didn't.
Right. So, right. But because usually when somebody leaves, there's a lapse, like between when they leave and we pay them out and then when the next person starts. But Cindy started the exact day Connie left. So there was no wiggle room in that budget at all. So I need a reserve fund in order to have that budget whole again.
So just so I understand the 5 weeks. You said it started out 7/1, so the fiscal year is
17.
Correct.
So we're halfway through.
We had to pay Connie out. So
for the full year, even though she's only worked for half the year?
No, it's way
fiscal year.
She gets it. It's not accrued. You get it at 7/1.
At 7/1, you get 5 weeks.
Yep.
So you quit at 7/2, 5 weeks pays out.
Yep.
Yep.
Genius.
So that was, if you remember, that was an issue that we brought up about 2 years ago. That was an issue that was brought up a couple years ago by this committee when we saw that in a contract. And the selectmen, when they I don't know if they've done it on every contract, when they did it in the next town administrator contract, which is the one that we saw it in, that language was changed specifically. As we probably know, union contracts take longer to negotiate, and hopefully this is going to work itself.
Now. We're right. So that, negotiations.
And I'm not saying that that's going to be, I mean, it's you have to negotiate and you have to bargain things, and it may or may not change, but
right.
That is an issue that was brought up and hopefully is on their radar.
It's like it's aware of it.
Yes.
That's a union position, COA.
No,
it's wages, so salary. It's wages.
The second question is, does Cindy's contract have the 5 weeks in an automatic?
She doesn't have a contract. She's the interim. The Board of Selectmen is voting, actually.
I want to make sure that this person that gets hired doesn't have that.
Here's the issue, though.
But if she becomes the interim, then...
So the issue is the next person. So that position, and I misspoke.
You can open that up differently. They don't. She doesn't inherit Connie's contract.
Connie doesn't have a contract.
She doesn't.
She's on a wage and salary.
It's under the bylaws, the personnel bylaws.
So the personnel, okay,
we
and then the
person. We have to rewrite the bylaws in order to change the wording.
And is it in the personnel bylaws, it says that they get?
5 weeks. Well, depending on her length of being here, she right. happened to be here for years and years, so right. she
well,
got.
It is, you get 3 weeks on day one.
At 7-1.
Right, because I believe yeah, the salary is always done to mirror union, I've always heard.
I would look at the way that we set up our policy. I don't know if that should even be in the bylaw. If that should be at the discretion of the Board of Selectmen to vote on an annual basis, those policies, and that way they can keep it in line. Because otherwise, now you've got the one chasing the tail that, well, the wage and salary is going to get it, so the union's never going to give it up. But if the union, you take it away from wage and salary first without the union having it, then it's an unfair on the other side.
But on wage and salary, the Board of Selectmen now, the person is the personnel.
But if it's in the bylaw, it's in the bylaw, so it's hard written. Versus saying, should it either be reduced in the bylaw and said it's just
right,
on
right, right.
Or to say that that's at the discretion of the Board of Selectmen to say, because maybe they want to make it 4 weeks instead of 5 weeks. But if you have it on one side, we all know this, that you got to kind of get everybody on the same page at the same time. So
someone has to submit a bylaw change.
So can you, on our behalf, let Margie know, who I know does all the town meeting stuff, that we'd like to have something done on that, if she wants us to do it, or if they can go through the selectman's office, all the better. But we're just looking to get it cleaned up so that it's either at the discretion of the Board of Selectmen, or at least written that it's on an accrued basis, on a however that works, a monthly or however Tim's contract was written. I like that. I forget what it says, but
you can't say about it like Tim.
No, I think we'd have to spell out exactly what it is, but
right.
So does everybody understand what these three or four?
Yeah.
Questions?
So on the 250, would it be easier to pay it out than at the end of the year to see if it's actually money to be done for transfers? That was only 250. It doesn't seem like you're saying I have to pay the 250 now, but I'm sure there's enough 250.
Enough in the budget now, and we wait to the end of the year?
The accounting budget, no. We have bare bones as it is. In the budget as a whole, I'm sure, I know what you're saying. I'm sure at year end, we probably will have something available.
The other thing is that you would have enough money, in theory, to get through to May.
Yeah, so at...
And then you'd be short $250 in May, and then we go to town meeting, and town meeting can do it. Or
so one
say it's inconsequential. And
one or the other. If these three get passed, just so you guys know, the reserve fund would then have, if these three get passed, $99,528.16. That's where you would be after tonight.
And that's after we took money out of town meeting.
That is, yeah. That's after the $21,000 for the fire and the $700 for the other insurance for Margie.
I know I ask this every time, but I'm sorry. There's no contingency fee.
We didn't put any money aside in the reserve budget for Norfolk. We did that years ago. The Norfolk County assessment.
Correct.
Years ago.
There's no specific line item for Norfolk County.
But no. We didn't put any money into the reserve fund. We did 4 years ago, and I always want to make sure. Okay.
There's no designated or
thank you.
Subtotal
yeah.
number.
Thank you.
It is what it is. But and we funded Norfolk Aggie this year.
We did.
With prejudice. We funded them last year with prejudice so that the only money that would be due would be back due money
right.
if and when an agreement has come to, which is going to be a different kind of
discussion. I'm going to ask next time it comes up, too. I can tell you that now.
My only concern right now is that I know that the fire department has had two injuries. I know one gentleman's back. I don't know if the second one's back.
Right.
Their overtime is going to be an issue this year. I know that the 500 is a single line item that if we don't fund it, then we're not paying our vendor that's supplied the service to us. So that kind of to me is an easy one. The other two, I know that we have to pay the money before the end of the year, but I would rather wait for now because I think both of them can make it work within their individual line items in their budgets to get through to May town meeting. And then at that point, you know, we leave it up to town meeting to actually take the vote, which we always like to do anyway if they can. And at that point, we'll have a much better picture on what exactly is going on because we might have to then at that point make reductions and say move from something else or shift or cut 4 hours here or something just to get by. So my position is, my intent is to fund these at some point, but not at this time from reserve fund.
Okay.
Is that the committee's sort of consensus? Because I don't want to give committees false hope too that if the committee's not in favor of doing something like that, to say that.
I'd rather wait till the end of the year to see where we're at.
But generally speaking, you're not opposed to, wouldn't be opposed to funding these.
I'm opposed to funding totally. No,
okay.
I'd like to see where we're at.
That's really the only issue. I have to pay them.
Right.
Contractually, I'm obligated.
Right, but in terms of like the 250, if town meeting said no, we don't want to do it,
right.
Then
so
for half week
be back earlier
than that, or in Cindy's department, no, because that's 5 weeks.
Cindy, right.
So that would get her to the end of May, because all of June and first week of May.
That's right.
I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
It's close enough. It's something.
So it would have to be done in the beginning of May,
right.
But. We have that time to do it. And it's only the salary. It's not like expenses or something like that. Does that make sense to the committee and generally in agreement?
I agree waiting on those two with the intention that I believe we should pay them.
We'd find funding at some.
Thank you.
Hopefully find funding at some later date.
I agree with that.
I'll make a motion to approve the
$500. Second.
Any more discussion on the five to approve the $500 from reserve fund transfer to go to the fund the annual audit line item in the town accountant's office. Any more discussion? All those in favor? Okay, so that's 6-0. Okay, so these other two we'll table for now.
Yes.
So budgets that we've received, or how about this? Do you want to tell me what budgets you haven't received yet? Or what's easier, because you probably have a list and I don't have a list.
Right. The major budgets that I do not currently have that I've been promised I will by weekend is the enterprise funds. I did receive DPW around 3 o'clock today,
yes.
So I think it was.
So that's on the.
Actually CC'd, so
yep, that's on the drive. And I know that there might be an issue with the drive. I'm going to do it tonight. I think that you have access to the folder inside, but not FY18, or some people don't. So I'll do that tonight.
Only other budgets I have not received are nothing major. It's emergency management, which has, I think, a $1,200 budget. Historical Commission, who I believe is still working on theirs, but they have a $500 budget.
I thought I saw Historical.
Then maybe I'm thinking of Forest Committee.
Forest Committee, I have not seen the Forest Committee.
So it's probably Forest Committee. I know one of them was talking to Tim.
Yeah, Historical asked for more money than they've had in the past because of the demolition day.
Oh, wait, so maybe I didn't get Historical, because that was the conversation I was remembering that they had with Tim.
Historicals in our folder, Historicals in there, and they have the budget and an add-on document.
Okay, so let me go look at that, because maybe I just didn't. I can look at that in the morning. But really, it's just water, sewer,
and
joint
I don't have
water,
emergency management,
and solid waste.
Yes.
So we pretty much have almost all of that. That's good.
We do.
Yeah, most of them came in on Christmas Eve or the day or the 23rd, which is it's before when they needed to, and when we asked them to.
Yeah,
I got bombarded with schools and police and fire and a lot of the big ones, and then library the week after and things like that, a lot of them that week between Christmas and New Year. So we're in good position. I do want to say that looking at the budgets quickly, and I haven't plugged them into anything, we're letting the town accountant handle that for us this year. Most of them did not heed our advice or request in terms of keeping within whether it was 1.9 or 2% or whatever the numbers were. Almost just about everyone that I've seen, at least of the big ones, blew right past that. I'm not saying that they were
invalid or not valid requests or reasons or anything like that, but it's, we're going to be in a similar position that we've been in the past. So I would say that as soon as we get that budget, you can start to look at them now. They're on there, so you can start to review them piecemeal sort of thing. We'll get them all compiled by the end of this month. And at that point, we'll have a better picture also on revenues, but we're going to have a hard hoe of it here come February and into March of, we're going to really need to go through these budgets with a fine-tooth comb, and why are we asking for more money? Because we all saw the revenues. There's not going to be a huge amount of new money. So start to take a look at the budgets that are on there. And so it sounds like, who's the Forest Committee?
That's you. Private committee.
I think I didn't mean if you could just reach out to Pat and find out what's going on. And you're in contact with the DPW for the enterprise budgets?
Yes.
Correct?
Okay. Yep.
So we don't need that subcommittee.
And emergency management, I'll have to check with Rick Roos because I have not heard from him.
Yeah, I did not see his.
Go ahead. What, PJ?
The last time we discussed increase of staff, I remember that we had discussed how it is usually you implement in increments, i.e. if you're going to increase the number of staff, you don't just do it all at once unless you have somebody leaving or somebody taking maternity leave or sick leave or whatever. I don't think we had ever actually rectified that issue or discussed how the town was going to move forward with that. So I just, now that you're mentioning like an increase, like a huge increase in the request of the budget from certain department, I'm pretty sure that's something that they should be thinking about, and that might help them in planning for their future need.
Yes, I mean, if they're asking for more staff, I think that we need to hold all of them to the same standard, that if they're coming and asking for more money than whatever that number is that we had asked them to come with, that they need hard evidence of why they need that money, what the benefit to the town will be for getting that additional money. And then it's on us as the finance committee to hold them accountable, that we check with them 6 months, a year from now, and say, okay, this is why you got the money, this was the benefit, did we actually get that benefit? Because as we all know, you try to do things and you have the best intentions, but you know, you try things and they don't work. And we don't want to, I get, hinder people from trying new things, but it's our responsibility to then hold them accountable, so if that didn't work, we stop doing that and try something else. And that is really, that's the finance committee's responsibility to hold them accountable to their budget. So when we meet with them on their budgets, it's not just about what are you asking for FY18, but we kind of have to go back and what did you ask for in FY16? What were you going to do with that additional money beyond, you know, just the normal increase or whatnot? And have you been able to do that? How effective has it been? And what are you changing course on? You tried this, okay, but now you're going to try something else, or you had great impact, and here you go. You're going to come with lots of data and numbers and say, you know, my things are improving significantly.
I think always a good example is that the one I always bring up is the school resource officer.
Yep. Mm-hmm. I was just thinking
about that. But of course, every child in school asks everyone, oh, he's every day, so. I think it's not going to do that. So I always say, so that was the big thing he really wanted, which is, I hope it's effective. We'll find out from him.
Because that was one of our change orders. We
had to
put a safe
in
there
for some.
Is it what?
A safe
for his fire.
Okay.
The other topic was, is there going to be a peaceful
workload? Yes, I'm kidding.
It's okay.
It's okay. Is there really a workload? Because they can show, okay, yes, I really need this person, but nothing has increased. The workload remains the same. And so, you know, that was something that I remember Tim stated that he was going to look into and try to have certain description, you know, towards staffing. But we never received anything.
Well, I remember last year, I think he had asked for in the selectmen's budget was some money for a human resource out of position or consultant or something, so that exactly, I think some of that groundwork that you need to do beforehand of positions, titles, descriptions, what actually is required of people, and then you can start to assess how are they doing their job to that, do they need additional resources, whether it's training people, whatever. But it's kind of one of these chicken and egg syndromes of
you don't have the money to invest in that sort of baseline information, so then you're just dealing with all the symptoms as opposed to the root of the problem. So I think that it's something that's worth it for us to understand and maybe look at that. If we're having all these, I feel overloaded, I need more for this, well, maybe it's better to say, let's take a step back and invest in this human resource or in this consultant position to kind of do some of that basic work for us to really understand it, because things might just not be efficient, that you might have these ones that are saying that they need more help, but somebody over here, as we all know, has extra staff or extra resources, I don't want to say staff, but extra resources that are available that really could go to something else, and whether it's shifting of workload or some of those resources to help, you know, get everybody's job done. We want everybody to have a...
I think Tim has, if I remember correctly from meeting with some, not a major thing, but sent off for the town hall to allow shifting.
Yes, yeah, he's looking for some additional hours within the selectman's office
that they be able to
float.
To instead of the town clerk or somebody, was there any old position, said, no, we have Florida, so on those busy days, I can move this person to help you, whatever else to alleviate having to get one position for each group.
That's not that. Is that 7 years ago that we had?
Yes, it was the first thing on my first show of the committee, you guys. Well, it wasn't me. You guys mentioned
that. But then it was all the who's. Well, it was the oversight. That was the issue. Well, whose budget? And then what workload do they do within a department? And who's going to oversee that? And unfortunately, when you know we have some elected departments, some appointed departments, and we have specific line item budgets. So how does that budget flow? That if they're doing work in that office, was it going to flow back? And who is going to be, you know, if at that point in time, if somebody doesn't like somebody, then are they not going to be able to get the hours in that office because they don't like me? I don't think we have that issue anymore. But it's going to be, those are the kind of types of questions that I think we need to be asking. What are you going to do? How are you going to prove to us that what you're doing is effective? All right. Anything else for tonight? We are scheduled to meet.
Amendments that have yes, come in since, so I just wanted to go over them. So I talked to Kevin briefly about how this will flow. I'm maintaining the spreadsheet, and when I give it to you at the end of January, I'll have one column specifically for all of these kind of amendments so you can see what they are and whatnot. But as we go, if any others pop up, I'll inform you about them. So right now I have four. One is pretty straightforward, the Council on Aging. Because of the retiree, we have the sick leave buyback over the next 3 years, and the amount that was submitted just was off by $700. It was too low, so I had to amend that. The other insurance line item that Margie submitted, I guess she had met with Jim, our insurance agent, right after she submitted it, and he actually recommended a 5% increase for FY18. So I put the 5% increase there for that. My budget originally did not include the maintenance fee for our new software system because I did not have the number yet from SoftWrite, but I have since got that. And today the school and I discussed what their portion of the cost is going to be based on all the different modules and what affects the school, what does not affect the school. And the final share, well, the final total is $31,416 for FY18 and forward. The school share of that is $7,731. And our share is $23,684, the majority of which is all treasurer's items, which is almost $16,000. So I can give this breakdown, I can email it to you guys. But that $23,684 is going to have to be amended into the accounting budget because it was not currently on there. The school had already budgeted for a SoftWrite item at $18,700, so they're actually, this is much lower than what they anticipated.
Can you just follow up with the TC's office then and see if, with adding this, are there going to be any savings on some line items? Obviously, I wouldn't expect it to necessarily offset, but, you know, or just say FY18, I don't expect anything because we're going to be kind of running dual systems and all this kind of stuff, but FY19, I would anticipate, you know, saving $2,000 or something, hopefully.
Don't know if I can... I know for myself, what I pay now for accounting software is, I think, $3,800. So I'm going from $3,800 to
$23,000. But just to be clear, we would save $3,800, in theory,
the next year.
We have a dual system for a year.
So I can find out. I don't know what we currently pay the treasurer's side of things.
Just so that it helps to understand that delta.
Why would that be for
you? You buy the software. We are. So this is only the maintenance part. So we pay, I think the total contract is $152,000. I don't have it with me. But we pay for all licenses once, which we're paying for this for current fiscal year out of the grant we got for the IT grant and the capital project funding. The $31,000, unfortunately, is all the maintenance fees for all the various modules we're getting, payroll, treasurer's cash book, general ledger, et cetera, what goes on. And that is what we have to pay in.
When you say maintenance, so if something goes wrong or we have a question, it allows us to call them up?
Yeah.
Yep. As well, help desk is basically.
Correct.
Yeah. Which we don't have now, other than last night, we really don't.
It's a very mom and pop shop at the moment that we deal with, which can be good and bad.
Yeah.
And why is the school share about a quarter of the total?
Because, so when I did the breakdown, I did at the very top, and I can provide this to you, all of the modules that strictly are the treasurer's office, things that don't affect the school, anything to do with tax billing mostly, the treasurer's cash book, all of those things that really has nothing to do with the school. Then at the bottom, I did all the shared modules, so attendance, employee payroll processing, general ledger, treasurer's receipts, which will flow, all of the school receipts that they deposit will flow to that. I totaled that section, that totaled $15,463, and we thought a 50-50 split on that was fair, because we're both going to be utilizing it pretty much the same.
Okay. Is any part of that in the treasurer's budget?
No, I was going to put it all on mine. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm going to have to add it somewhere, so if you'd rather see it. I have no preference, I guess, is what I'm saying.
It would make more sense to have it in one line item.
It would probably make it easier, so it's all charged to
track
one place.
And follow and see it, as opposed to little bitties here and there.
Is the, sorry, the, and I, sorry I don't know this, the new software that we're getting, is this purely for the financial part of the town, excuse me, for town finances, including schools? It has no other school benefit for, like, the school's not using it. Okay, this is my module for attendance, whatever else, but I also have a module in there for a school-only function. Attendance for the children, I have no idea. I'm just saying it's purely a financial software.
Correct.
Okay.
Yep.
So that's all they're going to use, of course, for their finances and their budgeting. And
to my knowledge, there is nothing that they will be using that we are not using.
Okay.
Okay, as far as allocating, you know, we're trying to find the actual cost of each of these departments, if treasury is there and part of that cost, you know, would it make sense to split between treasury and accounting?
Well, I mean, ideally, we'll get to a position come this fall, if town votes to change the accounts position to, or the, I'm sorry, not the account, the treasurer collector's position to an appointed position from an elected position, that's going to allow, which is on the ballot, town meeting voted to put it on the ballot last spring. So if that change is made, then that allows more flexibility, and I believe that the intent would be to start to more cooperatively have the finance departments, and maybe it's all under then one umbrella that you have finance departments and one budget line item that then is finance departments, and then you have the different positions within, which a lot of towns are able to do, which to your point adds a lot of flexibility, because if one department's overloaded, you can really start to mix and match people and resources, as opposed to right now you've got, you know, in theory three different with the assessors, accountants, and treasurer collector that, you know, they all work well together, and I'm sure that they share their resources, but technically the budget wasn't voted for a dollar to be spent somewhere that is tied to that person, so you got to be very careful in how you're doing that. So in theory, hopefully in the future, we're able to merge those together, and you have finance IT or finance software that is one line item. And probably what I would ask is that for FY18, instead of merging it in with all your other expenses,
yep,
to break it out as kind of like you do with the audit, that it's its own,
to do that, yes,
its own expense, yep, and that way it's clearer for us as time goes on to track in the future, pull out if we need to pull it out or something.
Yep.
That makes sense.
I have one last amendment. And so this is actually on the topic of trying to make every department's budget whole. I realized that currently DPW has a line item for gasoline. So everybody that uses our pump, which we are able to see who uses what, because we have various reports, school, fire, animal control, COA, police, and dispatch, all of that is just kind of staying in DPW. So what I'm proposing is I kind of did an analysis based on what was actually used by everyone in 16, what's actually been used to date for 17. Now I know the budget's already submitted, but I'd like to take out what I think we should from the DPW gas line, allocate it to the departments that actually are going to use it so they'll have their own gasoline line, and then every month I'm going to get reports starting in July for FY18 from DPW, and I'll just be allocating those costs, taking it out of DPW and putting it to the respective departments, which I did speak to the departments about already, and they seemed fine with it.
And that's a reasonable... I guess my first question is there's some accounting, manual accounting that has to happen with that, correct?
An entry every month.
Manual entry. Right. And is that, what's the benefit, what's the long-term benefit of that? Is there a long-term benefit, you think, or?
I like to see costs within the department that actually incurs them so that it has a whole picture. So really these costs for the last few years have kind of just been hiding in DPW, which I get there one place or another. They're with the budget, so I understand that logic completely, but we do something very similar with postage because it's all paid for by the treasurer's office, and every month we do an entry to kind of take it out of the treasurer's office and allocate it to the departments who actually use the postage machine. So it's kind of around the same logic for that.
And then so you'll have a portion that's left over is DPW.
Right, so they actually budget, I think, 101 or 110,000 in that line. They pay a lot of things out of it that isn't just related to the pump. So the amendment that I actually have here would take 21,350 out of DPW gasoline and allocate it to fire, animal control, COA, police, and dispatch. The school portion was actually just $120, so
not worth
it. Didn't, yeah.
So what would you, but that's just the actual fuel.
Correct.
Not necessarily if they have any other costs associated with, what are the other costs that would be associated with it? Maintenance of the pumps or something, or?
It didn't go that far. So I know, I mean, the reports that I have are for unleaded and diesel, and it's really just saying, okay, DPW pays $100 for fuel to actually fill the pump, and then these people are actually the ones that used it. So I'm freeing up DPW's budget and charging it to those that utilized it.
And then of that balance of the 89,000
yep.
rough number, a portion of that then has to be billed to the, would still be billed
it'll
to the
stay, enterprise. It'll stay in DPW.
It'll stay in DPW, but then we have to allocate a certain percentage to?
Through indirect.
Well, through indirect costs yep. for water, sewer.
Right.
Just the world.
Yep.
And that would be, that's the best estimate of the allocation of the overall. Like we've done in the past, we're just fine tuning. But the yes.
So on the indirect side, Tim and I are respectively doing the indirect cost project now. We're going to talk about that in the next couple of weeks to try to get that to you at the end of January, hopefully, as well.
Did you ever see, it might be a better question for Tim, the indirect cost or the project that the dispatch was working on?
Yes.
Is that completed?
It is not yet. No, we have a final draft. We actually just spoke about it today and we have a couple changes. Came out pretty good. So hopefully we'll have that in the next few weeks.
That's for indirect costs or a different project?
No,
you can explain that.
It's for the dispatch cost allocation module
for the charging. For the towns. Okay.
Yep.
Any other questions? So we'll be back in 2 weeks. We have a meeting scheduled for 2 weeks. It is an open agenda. So it should be a relatively quicker meeting, just touch base. Hopefully, I think I want to kind of look at revenues at that meeting just to touch base of where we were at the last meeting. And maybe at that point, Beth, you might have a big picture number for us, not the detailed of where things are, but to date that.
Maybe an update from police and fire or their overtime?
Yeah, I guess for
us. To have the open date, we can.
Who's the
police and fire on the overtime?
This is one thing I'm going to try to do. Who's the subcommittee for public safety? Can you reach out? I'm going to try to do this year of trying to have the subcommittees be as
yep.
the direct conduits. So if you could reach out to the fire chief and police chief also, but specifically fire on overtime and mm-hmm. how he's doing. And probably maybe come to our next meeting or send us, if he sends us an email, that's fine. He doesn't have to come to the meeting, but just kind of looking for a status. Sound good?
Perfect.
Meeting minutes from our last meeting on
12/12.
Is there a motion to approve the minutes?
Second.
Any more discussion? All those in favor? Okay. Anything else for tonight? Okay. We'll be back in 2 weeks. Motion to adjourn. Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Thank you. Gentlemen, have a bag.